Hey guys, it's Jacob from Living Healthy Every Day, and we've got a cool podcast for you today. Today, we're going to be discussing a little bit about estrogen and how it plays a role in men, and more specifically, women, and in the cardiovascular system, central nervous system, GI system, the ovaries, the uterus, mitochondria, and the brain. We're also going to be discussing menopause, polycystic ovarian syndrome, and some actions both men and women can take to improve their quality of life. So I'm here with Dr. Felice Gersh. Thanks for being here, Dr. Gersh.
Oh, my pleasure. Thanks for inviting me to join you in this very elaborate and intricate and very interesting conversation.
We're excited to have you here. She's an integrative doctor and American board certified OBGYN. She's an award-winning physician and international speaker on diseases commonly associated with women's health. And she's a medical director at the Integrative Medical Group in Irvine, which is in Irvine, California. So let's get started. Let's talk a little bit about menopause and how it plays a huge role in women's health.
Well, sure. First of all, the very title of this event, which is really a very monumental event in the life of every woman. First of all, no matter what a woman does, she can exercise, she can eat right, she can do everything possible, she will still hit menopause. It's completely unavoidable programmed, and so it's universal for women, and it really is a monumental event in a woman's life. Mm-hmm. I really dislike the title, the name that's given to it, of menopause, because it really belittles the real essential, like I said, monumental event that this is, because it really focuses on this relatively insignificant sort of aspect of this loss of estrogen and progesterone, which is the loss of the menstrual cycle. Mm-hmm. And that is a sign of loss of this rhythmic estrogen and progesterone interplay that is so essential for women's health in every regard. And it's really just focusing on the loss of the period. And sadly, women from the very get-go, when they're very young, when they're going through puberty, they're taught to hate that they have this rhythm, that they have this really beautiful rhythm of life that is the menstrual cycle. They're really taught to hate it. And the first thing that women are told is, it's the curse, you know?
Yeah.
Got the curse. And it's like, it's not the curse, it's the gift. It's the beautiful connection that women have with their universe and the giving of life and their life, the life that they have themselves. And so women are often told to celebrate mm-hmm. when they lose their menstrual cycle. It's like, great, now you don't have to deal with it.
Yeah.
But what they're losing because of the name menopause, and meno is just the Greek word for moon, mm-hmm. and pause, which is stopping. So it's the moon cycle, which is stopping,
yeah.
really. And it's really not focusing on the real medical implications, which are huge.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, I'm here, and as I mentioned to you before we started the broadcast, that I'm here to teach and educate and defend the most amazing hormone of the human body and essential for female health, which is estrogen. And so I'm here because it just can't stand up for itself. It doesn't have a lobby. And so estrogen is involved in every function of every organ in a woman's body. And when you lose the systemic production in the ovary, and then you lose this estrogen that circulates throughout the body, it has really an enormous impact on every aspect of a woman's life.
Mm-hmm. So let's talk about like a few of the problems that are related to it, like with bone health, inflammation, things like that, the loss of estrogen in menopause.
Well, you picked two very big things, and inflammation is sort of foundational. So there are receptors for estrogen. If we go back to the beginning of what is estrogen and where did it all begin? So estrogen, we found, actually existed because we found in very primitive creatures, like clam-like, like prehistoric clams, that they actually had the ancestral estrogen receptors. And why would that be? Because a clam doesn't reproduce like a mammal, like a human. So what did they need estrogen for? Because OBGYNs, and I went through all the training, and they're really taught that estrogen and progesterone are all about menstrual cycles and reproduction, and the big picture of what these hormones do is really lost. But when you go back and you look at the ancestral receptors for estrogen in creatures like clams that existed many, many, many millions of years before humans ever came onto the planet Earth, then you understand what estrogen is really about. It's the first of all the steroid hormones. Mm-hmm. It antedates all the other steroid hormones like cortisol and progesterone and testosterone and aldosterone. All the receptors for those hormones came later. Estrogen is really the grandmother hormone. And it existed for one main purpose, which is survival. So it actually is key to an organism's ability to regulate its appetite. So energy, production, and storage. And all the things that go into maintaining the health of any creature, like temperature regulation and seeking the right climate, the right time to sleep, the right time to eat. So all the other organs in the body are all orchestrated to work together.
Mm-hmm. So it's working on the circadian rhythm.
Exactly. Actually, in humans, the circadian master clock, which is sitting atop the optic nerve called the suprachiasmic nucleus, is controlled by estrogen and testosterone. There are actually testosterone receptors in the suprachiasmatic nucleus itself, and estrogen has receptors in some of the surrounding structures that actually feed into the suprachiasmatic nucleus to regulate its function. So they actually work together. And some of the function of testosterone is by converting into estrogen, and some of it is through receptors, particularly for testosterone in the suprachiasmatic nucleus. And that's talked about a lot in aging, which, of course, aging is viewed as just getting old in most people's minds. But to me, aging is really about deficiencies. And it starts with hormonal deficiencies. In women and men, it really involves both estrogen and testosterone, with the reverse of each percentage-wise. So men have like 10 times more testosterone than estrogen, and women have 10 times more estrogen than testosterone. We're a little bit different in that and many other regards. And so estrogen maintains every organ in the body. There are receptors in virtually every organ. So you can pick an organ, and I'll tell you all about how it has some kind of estrogen relationship.
So let's start with receptors. So you've got alpha receptors and beta receptors, estrogen receptors alpha and estrogen receptors beta. So what's the difference between the two? What do they do?
So it's the more we learn about receptors for estrogen, the more complicated it's getting. Mm-hmm. So initially, we only knew about one, so it was just called estrogen receptor. And then about 20 so years ago, they found beta, which was number two. So then they called the first one alpha, and then beta. And then they discovered the new kind, which are sometimes called like jeepers, which are basically membrane receptors. And it turns out that, okay, so the alpha and beta initially were thought to be nuclear receptors. Mm-hmm. So they needed what's called a ligand, which would be the hormone, mm-hmm. to bind the receptor, and estrogen would be the ligand. So they would go into the nucleus, and then it would work with estrogen receptor related types of things and so on to make things happen. And then eventually, and it would take a little while, a protein would be transcribed. The estrogen goes in, it hooks onto the right gene, and then you get messenger RNA, it goes back into the cytoplasm, it goes on the ribosome, and mm-hmm. you make a protein. Yeah. And often that protein is actually an enzyme. And it turns out that when you look at the entire array of enzymes in the body that do a million and one things, you find out that the genes that are involved in the production of these enzymes are truly controlled by estrogen. And so it's amazing. I have, slides where I list all of these different enzymes that are related to estrogen, and they control things like everything with the immune system, the production of like cytokines, which are related to inflammation, and chemokines, which mm-hmm. cause the white blood cells to come running to a site of infection or so, and respond. So they're like, the locating devices, the chemokines and the cytokines. But then also the enzymes that are involved with like in the brain, with cleaning up damage to the brain, and also in the body to create wound healing. Like estrogen is very involved in wound healing, which a lot of people don't know.
Really?
And of course, very without estrogen, you can't really heal wounds very well. Estrogen is involved in the genes that create angiogenesis, create new blood vessels, mm-hmm. that, and of course, the nutrients and so on that are needed to heal. Their estrogen is involved in lipids. So in terms of PON, or we call it PON1, mm-hmm. Helps prevent oxidation of LDL.
Yeah.
Now, LDL people always call bad cholesterol. Well, of course, there's no good or bad cholesterol.
Yeah. It's like, you have to look at oxidized LDL.
It's only when LDL, which stands for low density lipoprotein, it's just a carrier protein that takes cholesterol around the body, because cholesterol can't travel by itself.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like you, if you want to go to a long distance, you've got to get in a plane or a car. You need some kind of transport. So the cholesterol in the body has transport systems, and they're called lipoproteins. So they're not evil. Mm-hmm. They're just part of the way the body works. But what's evil is when you get inflammation.
Yeah.
And estrogen is the anti-inflammation hormone. And so when you get inflammation, you can get oxidation. That's why people take antioxidants. And
so estrogen is an antioxidant.
Yes, estrogen is an antioxidant. And one of the biggest antioxidants in the body is nitric oxide.
Mm-hmm.
And nitric oxide,
for vascular health.
That's right. And in other things too. And it's what they call a redox signaling agent. Redox mm-hmm. means reduction oxidation. So it helps maintain a state of antioxidation, basically, mm-hmm. except, it gets so complicated in certain situations. If you have too much, it's actually part of the immune system's response to an infection. So it's like so many things in the body. It can have like the yin and the yang, depending on the time, the date, and the location and the quantity, it can work in sort of opposite ways. But
how is estrogen working on nitric oxide?
So estrogen in a couple of different ways. So if we take the blood vessels, and this would be all blood vessels from the largest artery, like the aorta, mm-hmm. down to the smallest capillary, they all need nitric oxide to function properly.
Mm-hmm.
And the nitric oxide is produced by the endothelial cells. These are the special lining cells. And these special lining cells, once upon a time, we thought just were like a barrier, just like a liner. But they're not, like so many things, like the gut lining cells, they're not just there just as a protector. They actually have many functions they actually produce. So they make like little hormones, they make these different products like nitric oxide. And nitric oxide is also made in the gut, which we can go to next. Mm-hmm. But in the arteries, it's controlled by an enzyme called nitric oxide synthase.
Mm-hmm.
And this is controlled by estrogen. And so without estrogen, you don't make this enzyme, which then is involved in the production of nitric oxide, which is key to arterial well-being. That's why after menopause, the incidence of hypertension virtually skyrockets.
Mm-hmm.
It's almost, by the time a woman gets into her mid-70s, it's getting close to 100%. It's so crazy high, the incidence of hypertension. It's not age. It doesn't relate to age, it relates to deficiencies,
mm-hmm.
to lack of estrogen. So much of what is age, assigned is really lack of estrogen, including things like osteoporosis, which we now know is really an inflammatory condition. So much in the body is really inflammatory. And estrogen, as we were talking about also before the broadcast, about the incredible immune system, which is involved in everything, mm-hmm. as it turns out, not just fighting a cold, it's really everything. So the immune system is controlled by, and the answer to all my questions is always the same.
Estrogen.
So everyone gets an A in my class, because whenever I ask a question, the answer is always estrogen. So estrogen actually controls things like, mast cells. Now, mast cells have not gotten really the play, although I'm sure you know, because you're doing
absolutely
information. Yeah. Sure, probably more than I know about mast cells, but your audience might not know more than both of us, although the audiences, they know so much. But mast cells are sort of like the most ancient of all responding white blood cells of the body.
Mm-hmm.
And I just love mast cells. They're so interesting.
Oh, they're so cool.
So
they've got so many molecules that can come off them.
Mast cells are so involved in so much, and they're just barely getting, like estrogen, they're due, right? Because people don't think about mast cells. the only time they think about them, and they don't even know they're thinking about mast cells because they really don't get it, but they know that when they get an allergic reaction in their nose, allergic rhinitis, and they mm-hmm. get congested,
it's all
nose
mast cells.
They don't know that, but that's what it is.
So mast cells must have estrogen receptors.
They sure do. Estrogen receptors are in mast cells, and mast cells are the first responders mm-hmm. to, like, so the way that I talk about mast cells is, it's like they're the first responder. They're a part of the innate immune system. Mm-hmm. So something happens in the body and the body just says, protect, protect. And it sends off the mast cells and they just send their grenades. Mast yeah. cells are the only cells in the body that actually have within them tumor necrosis factor alpha. So yeah. they are set. They're like, they have little grenades. So it's like the way I look at it. Something is happening. Someone is trying to break into your house. Mm-hmm. You don't know who it is. You don't know why, but you know this is not like your child trying to get in, left the key home somewhere. No, this is a real invader. This is a real invader. And you're scared for your life, for your family. You don't care what you do. You're just going to try to, you know, prevent this. So you're going to throw lamps and you're going to throw, you know, books. You know, you don't care.
They just pretty much throw everything at it.
So, right. The kitchen yeah. sink, you can pick up the kitchen sink, right? So that's what mast cells do. They just throw grenades, you know? Yeah. So they cause like this, whatever explosion they can to kill this invader. The problem is when this gets uncontrolled mm-hmm. because estrogen is the controller of this. It's sort of like you have this totally armed military, you know, and they're there to fight, you know, they're there to defend. And, you know, like the grand commander, like, leaves the scene, you know, and then they just start, you know, throwing grenades and shooting. It's like, you know, crazy, you know, like, what are you doing? You're out of control. You know, you've got all yeah. these mass weapons and of destruction and you're just using them, you know, indiscriminately. So that's what happens when you don't have estrogen on the scene. You can actually have mast cells kind of going crazy.
So does it inhibit mast cell release?
You have when you have
degranulation of it,
right? And then you get this sort of explosion, and this can happen, for example, in the brain. Mm-hmm. You know,
you get brain fog,
and people get big brain fog, yeah. right? And so, estrogen is, you know, like you mentioned, and I say it's anti-inflammatory, and so the mast cells have estrogen receptors. So do macrophages. So estrogen, for example, controls the release of myeloperoxidase, mm-hmm. which is one of the markers that we use now for cardiovascular risk, right?
Yeah.
So you measure. So, you know, they say, what is MPO, myeloperoxidase? What is it? Well, it's one of these enzymes. Anything that ends in ACE is like an enzyme. So yeah. That's easy.
That's the easy way to recognize it.
Yeah, ACE, so it's got to be an enzyme.
Yeah.
So myeloperoxidase is part of the defense system of the body. And it's released by macrophages, another one of the white blood cells mm-hmm. that are part of the innate or first responder type of cells. And they're actually not the mast cells are the first, and then the macrophages come second. And they often will come to the scene of the crime, so mm-hmm. to speak, and they're called there by the different other cells, which can, depending on where it is, if it's in the brain, it could also be the microglia, and it can be the mast cells, and they put out their chemokines, you know, the signal mm-hmm. saying, come, and join the fight, and yeah. so on. And the macrophages come, and they release their myeloperoxide. Now, so this is actually really key if you have a cut on your arm, right? Say you have a cut, and you know how it gets all red, and it puts out that little clear stuff? That's the clear stuff is MPO, mm-hmm. myeloperoxide. So that little clear stuff is what it is, and it gets a little red. It's not infected. It's our own body's inflammation to keep the bacteria from getting in. The mm-hmm. problem is...
Yeah, it's acute inflammation.
Right, but that's controlled acute inflammation mm-hmm. because that's to keep you from getting an infected hand from that yeah. cut. But the problem is if you have little fissures and cracks in your artery lining where the endothelium is, the endothelial lining, because you don't have enough estrogen and you get inflammation... Then you get these little cracks and fissures, and the immune system responds the same as if you have a cut in your hand. It's like you have a little cut inside your interior artery, and it masses.
You get the hardening of the arteries.
Yeah, so it masses yeah. the inflammatory attack, mm-hmm. and you get the macrophages coming in, releasing their myeloperoxidase, and then you get this oxidative state, and then LDL, the, you know, LDL cholesterol gets oxidized, and you have oxidized LDL, which is no longer being prevented because you don't have enough estrogen, you don't have the other enzyme, the PON1, and so you don't have that enzyme to prevent the oxidation of LDL, and then you have the beginnings of plaque, atherosclerosis, and then that can, over time, exacerbate.
When it becomes chronic,
Yeah, then you end up with strokes and heart attacks and also vascular dementia, peripheral artery disease, where you get, you know, claudication in your legs, and it affects everything. You know, it affects your kidneys. There's really an epidemic of people with kidney disease, kidney failure, and also bowel disease, because you can have ischemic bowel, because arteries feed what? Everything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Once you have unhealthy arteries, you get unhealthy everything.
Yeah,
right?
Everything. No nutrients anywhere.
Right, not properly done, right? And so, and of course, high blood pressure because you have unhealthy arteries. And all of this is related to estrogen deficiency. Now, I have to always say, estrogen is a key player. But if you have other things, you can override even the benefits of estrogen. So you can have younger women who have estrogen, but they're still getting into trouble. They're getting diabetes. They're getting like polycystic ovary syndrome, which is huge problem from a metabolic point of view and fertility point of view, and you can still get into trouble even with estrogen, because there's never a this solves it all, you know, everything is a piece of the puzzle. So the way I look at it, your whole body is like one of those 1,000 piece jigsaw puzzles, okay? But if you have 1,000 piece jigsaw puzzle, and in order to put it all together and get the picture right of this amazing 1,000 piece puzzle, probably, you know, like 400 of those puzzle pieces are estrogen, but that still leaves another 600 that are, you know, related to exercise and sleep and nutrients and everything else. So, you know, estrogen is not the solution. It's just a big part of the solution, and lack of estrogen is a huge part of the problem. And of course, not just menopause that creates a lack of estrogen. It's also endocrine disruptors, which I'm you know, always just in great distress emotionally.
Let's just go over a quick list of what the endocrine disruptors are. So you got plastics.
So plastics and the whole world of plastics, which includes things like bisphenol A. And now when you see plastic containers and it says BPA free, it usually means it's BPS full. So
yeah, it's got
BPS
another.
Yes, has replaced a lot of BPA, but BP, you know, stands for bisphenol, which is from the petroleum world. And they just replaced it with something equally, if not more toxic, called BPS.
Yeah.
So you don't want to, you know, so if it's out of plastic.
You just get around that loophole.
You know what, they did the same thing with flame retardants, you know, and stick-free stuff, you know. They just changed they shortened the molecule, but it's still just as toxic, if not more toxic, you know, so they just skirt the law.
VOCs are awful.
That's right. So they can just modify them and suddenly they're legal, you know, after they outlaw one type, they just replace it with another type. So they kind of did that with BPA, and then there's phthalates.
Phthalates,
So phthalates are in like vinyl, a lot of floors, you know, these artificial floors that are vinyl type floors are full of phthalates. And then this other thing that is called scents. So you buy like shampoo and conditioner, and perfume, and it says fragrance. So what is fragrance?
Fragrance could be anything.
It's a phthalate, some kind of phthalate. So, you know, it's basically toxic. It should have skull and crossbones on the on the cover, on the label, because it's really toxic. So these are all endocrine disruptors, and they're associated with major problems for males and females alike. And when one of the things with polycystic ovary syndrome, it is associated with early age and even in utero exposure to bisphenol A. Because it's an endocrine disruptor, you only get one chance in life to make your systems in your body, and that includes estrogen and all the other receptors for hormones. And when you have endocrine disruptors in play in the body, then these receptors are not properly developed, and you can end up with a body that when it goes through puberty, it really, everything just explodes, because the systems are not able to function properly because the receptors are not receiving the information. you know, in terms of what is a hormone, a lot of people don't know, like, what is a hormone? What's the basic function of a hormone? It's to give information.
Yeah.
It's basically to deliver it. So it's sort of like the Pony Express, you know? So what happens if you get the messenger on the Pony Express and you give a message that's written in English? And lo and behold, the person at the other end who gets the message only speaks Chinese. So he gets the message and it's received, it showed up, mm-hmm. but it's not interpreted properly. They don't know what to do with this information. And that's kind of what happens when you have inappropriate receptors. The hormone could be there, but the message is not really properly received. And therefore, remember we said there's alpha and beta, and they are known as nuclear receptors. They have to create this protein or enzyme. Well, it doesn't get the message right, or what happens, it doesn't make the right enzyme, or it makes the wrong enzyme. It makes something completely different because it goes to the wrong gene. Mm-hmm. And then have what we talked about briefly, the membrane receptors, which it turns out that alpha and beta also act as membrane receptors, not just nuclear receptors. And they interact with each other. They can up and down regulate each other. They can block each other out. So it's the more that we learn, the more complicated this whole thing is. But the membrane receptors create fast responses, what we call like kinases. Mm-hmm. So they signals like instantly, whereas the nuclear receptors take time to make these proteins, but it all works together for the cell to know what to do. So if the receptors don't work, the cell just doesn't know what to do, and you're going to have illness. It's really that simple. And so these endocrine disruptors create havoc, and they're probably related to, you know, even things like autism and attention deficit disorder, behavioral problems, mood issues. They're linking it to things even like schizophrenia, mm-hmm. and so on.
Anything that affects the immune system is going to have effects on those diseases.
So, yeah. And it's really catastrophic. For example, a lot of people don't realize it, but lead, you know, they talk about lead, how bad lead is. Mm-hmm. But one of the reasons that lead is so bad is it's an endocrine disruptor. Mm-hmm. And in yeah. children, when
it's
you're
contributing to PCOS and menopause.
It does. Oh, yeah.
Well, and bone density. So like osteoporosis.
It's involved in a lot of bad yeah. things. It actually is a significant cause of hypertension in women. It's very, these are toxic heavy metals. And in children, it can create brains that don't work properly and can never be fixed because mm-hmm. You don't have a redo. You can't say, let's make that brain over again. You only get yeah. one chance. And mercury as well is an endocrine disruptor. These mm-hmm. heavy metals are really causing chaos.
Do these system. Heavy metals block estrogen receptors?
They work in a myriad of ways.
Or are they're just very oxidative and inflammation heavy?
Actually, both. Like mercury, for example, is a direct neurotoxin, mm-hmm. and it's also an endocrine disruptor.
Okay, so let's do both.
What you say, yeah. when something's an endocrine disruptor, the myriad ways that it can work, it's really gets so complex. Not only can they change the way the receptors, you know, form, but they can actually interfere with other hormone receptors, not just one hormone receptors, and the way the hormones are produced as well. I mean, it becomes just endless, the complexity of how things can go wrong. Mm-hmm. It's because remember, there's like if you just take estrogen, it turns out that if you have in certain areas of the body, you have more alpha or more beta dominant, and you can actually like have more beta, and then the beta can actually downregulate the alpha. So it's so complex because they can actually interact even within themselves.
Is that genetic that you have more receptors for each of those organs?
Well, like for example, in the GI tract, mm-hmm. Most of the receptors are beta, but not all. I mean, so it's a mixture, but the enteric lining, the gut lining cells, are predominant beta, but they're not exclusive beta. Mm-hmm. And in the brain, it's a real mix of where like a lot of the hypothalamus is alpha that controls a lot of the reproductive functions and a lot of the metabolic functions, mm-hmm. and a lot of the cerebral cortex and some of the other areas of the forebrain and so on have more beta receptors, but it's not exclusive. Mm-hmm. There's always a blend. It's always a mix. It's just which is more dominant.
Yeah.
And then that's why it's so playing with fire when the pharmaceutical industry creates what they call, well, now they're changing the names.
But xenohormones, like bioidentical?
Well, what they call SERMs, selective estrogen receptor modulators.
Oh, SERMs,
that's what the original term was for drugs mm-hmm. like meloxifen.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so what they really, they're supposed to not use the word SERM anymore, selective estrogen receptor modulator. I mean, even that's so, just the sound of that for me is like, makes my skin, you know, crawl, because they're not smart enough to be playing around with receptors. We don't, because of the complexity of how they interact with themselves, with each other, with other hormones and so on. But the idea that you can give a drug that only works on one type of receptor for, say, estrogen, like only works on beta or only works on alpha, is we're kidding ourselves, because these are way too complex for such things. And we don't know really what we're doing. We really don't know what we're doing.
Estrogen crosses the blood-brain barrier easily, right?
Yeah.
So it's going to be affecting the whole system.
Oh, yeah. I mean, okay. I worry so much about one of the biggest and most prevalent of all the endocrine disruptors that are being used are oral contraceptives.
Okay. Birth control.
Birth control pills. Yeah. Not just the pills, but the IUDs that are embedded with these progestins and the shots and the implantables. So they are all endocrine disruptors. And it drives me crazy when they're referred to as hormones and they talk about the hormones in birth control pills. They're not hormones. In fact, if you go to PubMed, you'll find that they're listed as endocrine disruptors, because that's what they are.
That's what they are, yeah.
Now, ethinyl estradiol is not estrogen. It's an endocrine disruptor. It would be like you put, you know, lead or mercury, which actually they do, right? Kind of in some of the vaccines, they put mercury.
But it's just, you know, little bits of that. That can't harm a person.
Yeah, you put some in a pill and, you know, you call it a prescription drug and it's okay. I mean, they used to give quite a few, it was like three decades ago, they gave a drug called DES, diethylstilbestrol. And it's an endocrine disruptor. It's very similar in many ways to bisphenol A, which tried to become a pharmaceutical. That's the most bizarre thing. Bisphenol A first came on the scene sort of vying with DES, diethylstilbestrol, to become a pharmaceutical, and DES won the race between the two because it had more powerful impact on the receptors. It was actually a more powerful endocrine disruptor. And it was given insanely, truly insanely, to pregnant women, with the idea that somehow it was going to prevent miscarriages, but which it did not do. But what it did do was create horrible deformities in both genders, but in particular in women, it created a situation where what was very rare, called adenocarcinoma of the vagina, occurred, and it killed some young women and also caused deformities so that these girls, they could never get pregnant. So it really, and who knows what else, you know, who knows what else. But, you know, those were the obvious things. And this was under the guise of a pharmaceutical, and they called it an estrogen. And so that's like crazy talk, you know?
Yeah.
It's like calling a strawberry-flavored jelly bean an organic strawberry. No, you can call it that because it's red, but it isn't that. It isn't. So these are like birth control pills, the stuff in them, they are not hormones. They're endocrine disruptors, and their sole purpose is to do exactly that, to disrupt the normal hormone development, production, and function of a young female, a reproductive female.
Just like we talked earlier, where females think it's a curse to have this cycle.
See, the problem is, it is what it is. The prime directive of life is reproduction.
Yeah.
Everything about our bodies is geared towards reproducing, you know? And so we have reproductive organs, and the rest of the body is here to support it. You know, it's really the way to think about it. So our ability to have a functioning heart and brain and muscles and everything are all geared so that we can live and safely reproduce.
Yeah.
And a female, when her reproductive time in life is over, approximately age 50, but there's quite a bit of variation, nature has lost its interest in that creature, you know, because since everything is geared towards reproduction and then raising the young, by age 50, you're done. So it just takes it all away. And of course, everything that surrounds reproduction is gone. You know, the metabolic homeostasis of the body, everything is no longer necessary. Once you don't care about this creature reproducing anymore, it all goes down the tubes. That's just what it is. But, you know, we can accept it or we can fight it, you know, because we don't want to have all the consequences of what we call aging, which is really loss of our hormones.
And so when someone goes through menopause, it's good to get on estrogen right away? Or what's the time frame of when to start?
So what you have to do is support, you know, if we say that 40% is estrogen and 60% is all this other stuff, you know, diet, sleep, exercise. So you really should have all of that right long before you hit menopause, right?
Yeah. Because lifestyle, you know, factors, diet.
Yeah, because if you already, you know, have metabolic dysfunction because of all those other things going awry, then throwing estrogen at that person may not solve all their problems. I mean, for sure it won't. That doesn't mean it can't help, but it's certainly not going to solve all the problems. And in fact, we now know that in order to utilize estrogen properly and have it properly expelled or detoxified from the body, you need to have the right gut microbiome. Mm-hmm. In fact, there's a whole new world that's called the estrobilome, which is the microbiome to detoxify estrogen. And that requires the right diet and all those other things. So that, and then you have to have a healthy liver, and we have an epidemic of fatty liver. So there's, like, you know, nothing is simple. So like I said, I want to make it very clear that just giving hormones is not going to fix a problem that's, you know, huge because of all these other bad factors. So a very huge part of being healthy, but it's not, you know, it's sufficient, but not, I should say it's important, but not sufficient, you know. You know, you need to have all these other things. But that said, assuming that everything else is in play and you're doing all the right things, the sooner the better. We now know that during those so-called perimenopausal years, which can certainly be years before the periods cease, there's already all this stuff happening, the bad stuff. We know that plaque is already starting to build up in arteries. Joints are already starting to disintegrate. Estrogen maintains joints. Elastin, which keeps ligaments and tendons soft and flexible, is estrogen controlled.
That's awesome.
So when you get past menopause, a lot of women develop osteoarthritis and joint problems. Cartilage, collagen, is all related to estrogen. Mm-hmm. So remember we talked about healing. So micro injuries are not healed properly without estrogen. Mm-hmm. So you get buildup of damage and you get unhealthy tissue. And then things that used to flex and bend, dead, what happens? Hair rip and break, right?
Yeah.
So you do the same thing you always did, only now you tear your meniscus. Never would have happened 15 years ago. You bend over wrong. You lift. I've had patients where they just made a fast move with their arm and there's something in their shoulder ripped, you know, because low estrogen, you know? So their ligaments and tendons are not healthy. They don't, you know, sudden movement and just, you know, tears. People have that with their backs. So, you know, things really, really change. And these changes start in the perimenopausal years. During the perimenopausal years, they've done studies. Virtually every woman thinks she's getting demented because her memory really goes terribly south. Because, and she can't remember names. And it's the brain is really altered. It's an unfortunate thing. Nature really did a job on women. So when their estrogen production goes down in their ovaries, for whatever reason, the brain makes estrogen. I mean, that's how men get estrogen. And men have tons of estrogen in their brains. It's made on site. The estrogen, the brain is called a paracrine organ. It makes estrogen. There are many organs in the body that make their own estrogen as well. Mm-hmm. That's how children get estrogen, which is so key to their brain. That's why lead in the brain is so terrible. So, but the problem is the production of estrogen in the woman's brain drops in unison with the drop in the production by the ovaries. So it's like double whammy on the brain of women. And so it's never the same, but it does sort of even out after a while. But women have almost three times the incidence of Alzheimer's as men. And women end up with more strokes than men.
Let's talk about what estrogen is doing in the brain. So it helps with neuroplasticity and neurogenesis.
It does. You hit that right on the head. So it has many different effects. It has direct effects on the neurons, and it has indirect effects through the immune system, the microglia, and the astrocytes. So they all have estrogen receptors. And so the astrocytes and the microglia are amazing and just so incredibly interesting. They're part of the immune system. They're residents of the brain. Mm-hmm. They actually enter into the brain during the in utero phase of life. And they are there to protect and maintain. It used to be thought that the microglia only acted as sort of phagocytes. They would gobble up like dead tissue. but which they do, but it's way, way more complicated than that. And they used to call them resting or activated, but when they're resting, they're not really resting. They're like on surveillance status.
Yeah.
So they're always at work. They're never resting. They're like our guards of our brain. Never resting. They may look like the guards in front of Buckingham Palace, but they're not. They are alert, right? They're not statues. They are alert, right?
Yeah.
All the time. And our microglia are always alert, and they make all kinds of signals. They put out, you know, all these like amazing signals that can draw in the event of a real infection. They'll actually put out the chemokines. They'll put out signals to draw in cells from the peripheral circulation, mm-hmm. the different white cells that are part of the fight against infection. The problem is that they are controlled by estrogen as well. So once again, it's kind of like the same scenario. Without estrogen there to help them be organized and controlled, they don't know what they're doing without estrogen. And so they put out these signals and bring in inflammatory cells, and then they create, you know, like basically havoc. They put out things called matrix metalloproteinases.
Mm-hmm. MMPs.
That means it's an enzyme, right?
Yeah.
So these are part of what we call extracellular tissue remodeling. You know, that's everything is always sort of being remodeled, you know, and so forth, you know, because things die and you have all this extracellular stuff, mm-hmm. things that are, you know, like outside the cell, and the microglia are part of that whole thing, and they make these other really interesting enzymes. And one of them is the number 9, which is very key, but there's quite a few of it. That's why they have different numbers.
Mm-hmm.
And estrogen controls these enzymes being produced, and without proper control, these create havoc once again. And it's we know the microglia also help control the production of like amyloid protein, which builds up in Alzheimer's. They help to gobble that up and clean up. That's also part of like the extracellular matrix, is what this amyloid protein garbage
mm-hmm.
is.
Yeah, amylin contributes to that. Yeah.
We need properly functioning the microglia, and the astrocytes are kind of like also like the master guards, and they communicate. They're on the blood vessels, and they directly also communicate with the neurons. It's a whole elaborate system, which is actually this. If you look on PubMed, there's a lot of recent articles. I mean, this is an area of real active learning right now, is mm-hmm. how astrocytes, how the endothelial cells of the arteries of the brain, how they all interact and interrelate with the neurons, and it's, you know, how they all, it's all like this grand coordinated plan.
Yeah.
And I always think of estrogen as sort of like the master general in command, and watching over all of this stuff happening and putting out the grand, scheme of things, like this is what you do. And it's like the troops without the general is really sort of what happens. And they kind of fend for themselves for a while, but after a while, sometimes they fire on each other, right? Friendly fire, because they don't know who the enemy is anymore. They just fire at each other. And that's sort of what happens in the brain without estrogen over time.
Mm-hmm. So what else is it doing in the brain? Estrogen's doing in the brain. It's works on glucose receptors, right?
Well, estrogen is what we call the GLUT, the GLUT transport system.
Mm-hmm.
So estrogen, the primary source of energy, the source of energy that the brain loves the most is glucose.
Mm-hmm.
So, but fortunately, our brains can also use an alternative source, which is ketone.
Yeah, from beta hydroxybutyrate.
Yeah. So, and the butyrate, of course, the short chain. That's a whole right.
Another we can get in that in a little bit, but yeah.
Talking about short chain fatty acids, and it can use ketone bodies. So, you know, the brain is very resourceful, and our bodies have allowed our brain to use virtually anything possible as an energy source, because mm-hmm. we need to be able to think. So, but the primary favorite one is glucose. And in order to get glucose into the brain, you need a certain transporter system mm-hmm. that we call, the GLUT system, like GLUT2, GLUT4, and estrogen actually controls that glucose transport system. Mm-hmm. So without estrogen, you don't have proper transport of energy into the brain. That's why they sometimes call diabetes 3, which is when you have dementia.
Oh, type 3 diabetes, yeah.
Diabetes, right, because you're not really transporting properly the glucose mm-hmm. into the brain, and then it's not used properly, because you need to get it in through the blood-brain barrier, and then you also need to get it into the cells. And that's actually the glucose transport system, both cellularly and through the arterial system, is actually all controlled by estrogen. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the reasons why after menopause, the incidence of diabetes and prediabetes just skyrockets in women, even slim women, because estrogen controls glucose transport. Mm-hmm. And so that's a huge problem then, because the energy to the brain is not being delivered properly. That's where this whole thing about eating fat sort of became a fad, you know, like eat fat, good for your brain. Well, that's sort of the back doorway, and I'm not against, if you have advanced dementia, you know, to do what you have to do, you know.
An alternative fuel source there.
Right. Yeah. You have to, because you're like, the system is so broken. But rather than trying to find an alternative fuel source, why don't we try to fix the problem at its source and get estrogen in and get it in early before you develop transport glucose problems, you know, so that your body isn't working properly and you have to... Because when we give people diets that are very, very high in fats and very low in vegetables and fiber, we actually damage the gut microbiome even further.
Mm-hmm. So let's talk about the gut and the microbiome and all that. So let's start off with like gut health and how the gut works. So maybe we could talk about how you have the secretory IgA layer, the bacteria in between it, and then you've got the different cells and the tight junctions between. So what is so great about the microbiome? It's a huge topic now. I know a lot, but for
we can hear for a few days, but in it turns out that we have this secret advanced civilization that resides all over us, but the focus, and we'll focus for now on the gut, because we have microbiomes of everything now. Mm-hmm. Things that we used to think are sterile actually have a microbiome, like the ovary has a microbiome, the placenta, the uterus, everything has a microbiome.
Every single thing, yeah.
Because, you know, it just seems so amazing that I actually at one point believed that bacteria just went so far and then they just stopped. Like, what would keep them from going further? Was there a big sign that says, stop, turn around, do not go further, bacteria not welcome? I mean, they don't, you know, so there was like no reason to
it's like a symbiotic relationship between.
Yeah, there's no reason to think that bacteria wouldn't get up into your fallopian tubes just as a normal thing. So, of course, they really are there all the time. In terms of the gut, you know, there are trillions of bacteria, hundreds of different bacterial strains, and this is a very complex civilization. And you need to have a great diversity of different types of bacteria, because it turns out that they actually have different jobs to do. And they work on different food products to create metabolites, or, you know, byproducts of the food you eat. They produce different types of metabolites. And these different metabolites actually can, some of them can circulate through the body, go to the brain, go to other cells, and they can actually act on receptors like hormones. They actually get in. And so it's like, that's why we talk about food now as medicine. But in order for the food to do its job, to do all these interesting things like food as hormone, food as information, you actually need the right gut microbiome to break it down into these
metabolites for it. Yeah.
Right. And that's where we talk about the estrobolome, the gut microbiome that's specifically there to break down estrogen and estrogen metabolites, and that without that, you do increase your risk of certain cancers, it turns out. Well, it also turns out that having the right gut microbiome is key to the health, not just of everything in your body, including your brain, but to the gut itself, which seems like not very surprising. So that bacteria, when you have the right bacteria, they make mucus. Like one of the kinds is called Archimonzia mucinia, and they make a mucus that actually coats the lining of the colon. And it actually acts as a protectant, okay? But if you have the bacteria in the wrong place, like in the small intestine, it creates inflammation, and then you get mucus, just like you'd get in your nose if you got inflammation, you get mucus, and that can actually then impede digestion and absorption of nutrients. So in one area, it actually acts as an impediment. In another area, if you don't have the mucus, you don't have the protective coating. And then if you have the wrong bacteria, they make these particles called LPS, lipopolysaccharide, also as endotoxin, like toxin from within, which can actually pass through the lining to what we call the GALT, the gut-associated lymphoid tissue, where at least like 70% of all your immune system lines the intestinal tract. And this includes both the innate and the adaptive immune system. So you have the different kinds of white cells, you have the lymphocytes, and they all work together in this great appropriate harmony when things are right. But when you have this this outpouring of endotoxin or lipopolysaccharides into that layer of immune system, you can just have chaos. You create inflammatory cytokines, you create systemic inflammation, and you know, you can increase your risk of every kind of disease, autoimmune disease, cancer, dementia. It's like you have poison literally flying out of your intestinal tract, and your immune system goes just like haywire with what's happening. And you can also get particles of food, proteins that have never been recognized by your immune system that can go down this pathway that can lead to autoimmunity, which is now rampant in children. Now the incidence of type 1 diabetes is like 700% higher than it was just like 15 years ago. It's really horrifying. And the more you check, the more you find that, you know, Hashimoto's auto antibodies for thyroid, to the point where doctors are just saying, it's so common. It's like, that doesn't, the fact that it's common.
Yeah, what is going on? Look,
I know, like, at a certain point,
read a study.
Okay, I don't, you know, it's like we have so many diseases that are so common, but it's not okay. A lot of people think this is part of allergies and food allergies as well. And people think, well, this is so common, it's like normal. No, allergies are not normal. It's an aberrational immune system. You're not supposed to be allergic to dogs, cats, and trees and grass. You know, that's not the way our bodies evolved. This is all aberrational. And so it's really, you know, very complex, but, you know, you really need to have this mucus protectant, you need to have the right bacteria, and we know that lack of estrogen is very key in terms of maintaining the gut health and the right gut microbiome. And also there's this other old thing that we call the enteric nervous system, which is the nervous system of the intestinal tract, which has actually its own set of glial cells. They have the enteric glial cells that are the like cousins of the microglia in the brain, which are also the immune system. And all the different layers, every single part of the intestinal tract has estrogen receptors. In fact, the GALT, the gut-associated lymphatic tissue, which has these islands of lymphatic tissue, which lymphocytes are produced in, called Peyer's patches, they actually make estrogen. It's so important to have estrogen in the gut and in the immune system that they actually make their own supply of estrogen. So it's estrogen's involved in all aspects of the gut. And like we talked about, the circadian rhythm is actually regulated by estrogen. And it turns out that the bacteria, the microbiota,
they have their own circadian rhythm.
They do. Yeah. They have, and they have to be put in sync with our own cells.
Just like right? Mast cells have their own circadian rhythm.
Right. They all cells have.
Right? Everything all, does.
They all have to keep the beat. And estrogen helps to keep the beat. And it turns out that in order to keep the microbiome having the right rhythm with the rest of the cells of our body, you also need to have estrogen. And so it's really quite an amazing thing. You know, and there are things you can do to try to work around it, like with timed eating. You know, if you eat at exactly the same time every day, you can educate the cells as to what time it is. So, you know, there's a few
Something
things
like
that you can
intermittent do. Intermittent fasting, kind of.
That helps, too. That's right. So there are things that we can do to try to help get the timing right. But estrogen is the master of keeping the time for our bodies.
That's awesome.
It is. It's the more you learn, the more you want to learn.
There's just so much to be discovered. So it is. You've got the microbiome. They're producing short-chain fatty acids.
Right. So short-chain
butyrate, acetate, and propionate. And
so they're the fibers that you eat in food, in vegetables, right? You don't get these fibers by eating a hamburger, right? This is eating vegetables. That's why you have to eat a lot of vegetables, okay? Just what it is. And all kinds of vegetables, root vegetables, the ones that are really starchy that people said, don't eat them, they're too starchy. They're the food for our microbiome. And we didn't realize we had this critical microbiome. So inadvertently, we've been killing them with toxins and antibiotics and starving them, and we've got to nurture them. We've really got to nurture and care for that critical trillions of cells in our body that are so key to our health. And what happens when they get the fiber is that they go down the assembly line, and the end products are called short chain fatty acids. And they have different functions, you know, the propionate and the acetate and the butyrate. The butyrate has gotten a lot of focus because it seems to act as food for the lining cells, the enterocytes themselves. And as well, they pass out and go through the body and go right to the brain, and they seem to be nourishing the brain as well. And they also act as signaling agents with the enteric nervous system to communicate as well. So they have they also help to kill bad bacteria. So they act as
antimicrobial.
Yeah. That's right. So it's they help to keep out the bad guys. So they're so multifunctional in so many ways. Signaling agents, food, killers when they have to be for the good cause, and so on. And propionate and acetate are very important as well in regulating glucose metabolism. They are heavily.
So they go to the liver, right?
They do. They're involved in what's called intestinal gluconeogenesis. And they go through the liver, and then they feed back to the brain, and there's like nerve cells in the portal vein, and it's all complicated.
Yeah.
But there are cells in the lining of the intestine that actually make glucose, and this acts as a signaling agent and helps the brain to know when you should eat and when you should stop eating. Okay, so it regulates glucose. The whole glucose homeostasis of the body is regulated through intestinal gluconeogenesis, which is controlled by the short-chain fatty acids. So if you don't have the right bacteria, you're not going to control glucose regulation in your body. Of course, that increases your risk of everything bad, metabolically speaking, including, of course, diabetes and all the offshoots, which are the cardiovascular disease and the dementia and so on.
Mm-hmm. So what's the difference between... I know you probably can't make acetate and propionate as well, but what's the difference between eating a lot of like being on a low-fat, high complex carb diet versus a high-fat, low-carb diet, something like a ketogenic diet where you're producing beta-hydroxybutyrate versus eating a high-fibrous diet that has high complex carbs and things like that and creating butyrate as a substrate from your bacteria?
Right. So really what they've shown is that in the long haul, you want to eat a diet that is extremely high in complex carbohydrates in the form of things like vegetables, right? And then I'm not an anti-grain person. It just has to be really high quality whole grains and not processed grains, of course.
Yeah.
But I don't see organic corn, brown rice, and things like quinoa as evil. There's just not a whole lot of buckwheat. I mean, there's just not a lot of whole grains. Once it's turned into a flour, it's not whole anymore. So it has to be cooked, you know, like organic. And it always has to be organic. I mean, corn is evil when it's GMO. I mean, that's...
Yeah, really.
Right. So, you know, it has to be, you know, organic. And there are many civilizations have lived for a very long time with a lot of healthy grains. And there's a lot of B vitamins. Now, the whole paleo movement was based on the idea that humans were designed to eat a certain diet going back, you know, many thousands and thousands of years ago, like predating the agricultural revolution. So we're going back, you know, well past 10,000 years ago. But that all came about, the whole paleo concept came about before we understood the microbiome.
Yeah.
So it didn't take into account that, you know what, we're not eating just for us. We're eating for those trillions in there, right? That's it changed the whole paradigm for me. I was actually very pro.
Those are the things that are turning on our genes.
Yeah, we
just like those, mother's milk isn't actually feeding you as much as it's feeding your microbiome.
That's right. The oligosaccharides in breast milk is phenomenal finding. So we did not know this when they came up with the paleo diet. We didn't know about feeding the microbiome and the critical nature and importance of the microbiome. So I am not in favor of the paleo diet the way many people eat it. You know, paleo is more about exclusion than inclusion because some people do paleo and basically all they eat is meat and saturated fat from meat. You know, I'm not into that. But if you consider paleo as you're eating whole foods and healthy foods and organic foods, you know, that kind of concept, I'm all for it. But I'm not in favor of a high protein diet. We know that protein is proliferative, pro-aging. So, you know, you do need protein, of course, but you don't need a lot of animal protein. Now, if your goal is to build a lot of muscle and you're like a weightlifter, then you will need to consume more animal protein, but that is not part of like a longevity strategy, you know. Yeah. So that's a different, you know, you have to decide what are your long and short term goals.
Yeah.
But that's
and eating too much protein goes through a whole cycle that you get a byproduct of ammonia. And if you have problems with estrogen, then you're gonna have problems with detoxing that ammonia with the nitrogen.
Absolutely.
There.
Absolutely. So we know that people who tend to be the bodybuilders of the world with the Muscle Man magazine cover people, they tend not to be the longest lived people on the planet, you know?
So
it depends on what your goals are. So the kind of the diet, you know, I say, you know, you have to nurture and eat for your microbiome.
Yeah.
And that means you have to eat a lot of different fibers, and healthy grains are actually very good for your microbiome. So I'm in favor of that, but with a plant-based focus. And in terms of animal protein, if you are sick, like say you have metabolic syndrome, you're very overweight, you're a very inflamed person, you get lots and lots of labs on patients mm-hmm. to really know what's going on with them, I recommend starting out for the first few months, not for life, but for the first few months with a vegan diet, because it's turned out that if you don't have the right microbiome, you cannot properly digest animal protein. So if you have, even if you eat a lot of vegetables, they have a lot of nitrates, and nitrates
turn... In the oral microbiome, nitrates turn nitrate, and then you get...
Nitric oxide pathway, right? And you can get a significant amount of nitric oxide, not just by your arteries with the nitric oxide synthase, but also through the food within the gut itself.
Mm-hmm.
But in order for that to happen, you know, you need the right microbiome in the mouth, and you need stomach acid, and you need certain minerals and vitamins and so on. And so that's really important. But it turns out that if you have an unhealthy gut microbiome, then what you will do, because a lot of the nitrates get also passed down into the lower part of the intestinal tract, where you can actually make nitric oxide down in those areas as well, not mm-hmm. just in the stomach.
Yeah.
But what happens is that if you don't have the right microbiome to do the processes properly, then what you end up making are what are called nitrosoamines. So the animal products combine with the nitrogen products to make these products that are actually carcinogen.
Mm-hmm.
And as well in the gut, you also can make from like carnitine, which comes from like red meat, and choline, which is
maybe like TMA, right? Or TMAO. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. You really do know. I'm impressed. Yes, you make TMA, then it goes to the liver. You make TMAO, which is both a marker for cardiovascular, you know, not well-being, for cardiovascular risk.
And that's only when you have dysbiosis.
Yes, yeah. And TMAO is a toxin, direct toxin as well. But that will only happen if you have dysbiosis. So it takes the confusion out of, why is eating red meat evil? Like, say it's healthy, grass-fed red meat. Why are eating eggs bad for your heart? Like, this doesn't make sense, right? Because humans have eaten these foods.
You need choline. You need those healthy fats, yeah.
Choline is critical. You want to make phosphatidylcholine and maintain your cell membranes? I mean, that's pretty critical, right?
Absolutely.
How could these foods be evil? Well, they're not evil. The problem is that we've created this crazy dysbiotic gut, right? We never in the history of mankind had gut problems like we have now. We have the wrong bacteria living there because of the toxins that we've consumed and all these other things, you know, like we won't even go into glyphosate. That drives me crazy, you know, it's so toxic for the, by the way, an endocrine disruptor. It's an estrogen endocrine disruptor glyphosate, which is part of Roundup and GMO foods.
Mm-hmm.
The bottom line is that we now have such dysbiosis of our gut that if we eat these really healthy foods, we're making poisonous byproducts, you know, so we can't eat those foods.
Yeah. I had dysbiosis a couple of years ago with a high amount of citrobacter friendi, and I had to go on antibiotics, but I really found a vegan diet really helped because I was eating tons and tons of fiber, and that really got up my count. And then I did a U-biome test, and it showed that my diversity was a lot higher than it was before.
It will help, right? Yeah. And
like resistant starches and things like that.
Like periodic fasting, mm-hmm. like I worked with the Longevity Institute at USC, where they developed a fasting mimicking diet, where if you do this periodic fasting or fasting mimicking diets, it seems to help increase gut diversity. And some of the theories on that is that, assuming you have an appendix, hopefully people have appendix still, that the appendix is sort of the hidden reservoir keeper. You know, it mm-hmm. keeps the keeper of the ancient gut bacteria where they hide out, you know, for safekeeping. Yeah. And when you get to a point where the body says, now or never, let's release them because we may die, we may starve to death, so we got to do everything in our power, it releases some of the bacteria from the appendix into the colon itself to help reseed it. So you can increase diversity through periodic fasting and fasting.
That also increases acromantia, I think is the
acromantia mucinia, yeah. Mm-hmm. Increases mucus, yeah. Well, all the good guys.
Okay, hopefully. Yeah. That's been shown to be low in, like low in obese patients, right? And high in...
Dysbiotic. That's where they lose. And then they get the leaky gut, you know, the impaired gut barrier function and the endotoxin pouring out, all the inflammation. And when you eat a diet that's high in fat, like a ketogenic type of diet, they've shown now, there's studies that show that you actually select for bad bacteria. You actually create dysbiosis. So I really am against this craze of ketogenic diets. I think that periodic ketogenesis, you know, being in a ketotic state through doing periodic type fasting, mm-hmm. which creates a ketotic state, but only for a short period of time, a few days, not months, few days. And then you go back into your high plant-based diet is really the best way to go.
So like kind of like a... vegan cyclic ketosis type of
almost vegan, not quite vegan until your healthy gut is resumed, right? Mm-hmm. Restored, and then almost vegan, but you add some animal back mm-hmm. and some saturated fat, which by the way has been shown to improve mood if you have some saturated fat mm-hmm. And then you do intermittent ketosis. Exactly, you got it. That's exactly what I promote.
That's awesome. So what else is, let's go back to dysbiosis. What else is like a clinical parameter of dysbiosis? Like maybe like lower hormones and lower neurotransmitters, serotonin, ghrelin.
Well, when you have dysbiosis, you're going to have systemic inflammation.
Yeah.
Because of the impaired gut barrier. And that will lead to cognitive problems and mood problems. So it's interesting you brought up mood. So mood is heavily related to gut, mm-hmm. right? So if you have an unhealthy gut, you're going to have a bad mood. You know, you're going to have increase in anxiety and depression.
Yeah.
So it's a whole new thing. They call it nutritional psychiatry. I love it. Actually a few psychiatrists who actually recognize that nutrition matters. And not just giving it an SSRI, you know?
Yeah.
It's crazy. But that's, you know, sort of a novel idea that the brain needs nutrients and that the brain, if it's in an inflamed state, is not going to function well.
Mm-hmm. So it's not that communication.
When you have out of control microglia that are responding to an inflammatory state because the blood-brain barrier is letting all these inflammatory cells through and all this, like the endotoxin gets right into the brain, mm-hmm. okay? It creates inflammation in the brain. It's a big mess. That is going to affect mood. So anxiety and depression, 25% of women are on antidepressants now. It's a horror, you know, terrible. And of course that affects sleep. So how many people are on sleeping medications?
Yeah.
It's just a disaster. The poor brain is just taking it big time from gut dysbiosis.
Oh, it's strong. It can endure a lot.
Stop madness, right? Don't eat processed food. Don't eat GMO food. Don't eat sugared garbage. Don't eat pretend, you know, like soy, you know, processed soy, you know. Don't be
What's your opinion on soy? Soy with estrogen?
Phytoestrogens are very important. It turns out that they can act on the receptors as if they were estrogen. And actually, remember, we said estrogen is good, you know, mm-hmm. so it's actually good. But you don't want to eat, soy processed. Well, definitely, soy is heavily GMO. So you do not want to eat GMO soy. And you don't want to eat processed soy. So you're just limited to miso, tofu, and umami. That's it. How can you eat soy pretending to be ice cream or to be mozzarella cheese or turkey?
Yeah. For all those vegetarian, vegan alternatives and things like that. Yeah.
Processed garbage. Right. Not good. And lignans are very important. The most key lignan are flax seeds. Flax seeds, lignans are actually a phytoestrogen, and they make what's called Equal, which is has been shown to have dramatic benefits in also reducing breast cancer. So these are all very, very key health foods to eat. A couple of tablespoons of flaxseed every day is great.
Okay. Yeah, because some people like think it's like highly inflammatory. Is that working through like a?
No, it's not highly inflammatory.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay. Well, let's talk about like hormetic effects with foods.
Polyphenols. You know,
polyphenols work through hormesis.
Hormetic means a little bit goes a long way. You know, so so a little bit can have dramatic effects. It can actually work on cell membranes, actually bind to hormone receptors and create amazing effects. So I'm a big advocate for a lot of these extracts like resveratrol and quercetin. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's pretty amazing some of the effects that they can have. Curcumin. These are, of course, some of the most well-known ones of these showing hormetic effects of these polyphenols. So mm-hmm. they're wonderful. And of course, you know, taking spices is great, you know, so load up on spices, basil and thyme and oregano, because a little bit can have an amazing impact for your health.
Mm-hmm. As long as you know what spices you're putting in, not just spice that you grab from
they have to be organic, preferably fresh.
Yeah.
It's done with awareness and thought, right?
Mm-hmm. It has to have some nutrient data to it to feed.
And that reminds me of my law, Dr. Gersh's law. It's punishable by ill health because I'm not there to punish you. But it's basic and it's so simple. Everything you eat should taste good, and everything you eat should be good for you.
Yeah, I don't disagree with that.
Garbage. You know, there's plenty of good stuff. If you want to do recreational eating, even though, you know, you really shouldn't, but you want to, then eat something that's good for you.
Yeah, really.
Don't eat junk, ever.
Yeah.
Never a reason. And never let people tempt you, right? Friends don't give other friends heroin, right? If they're giving you, you know, Cheetos, don't eat them. A bagel, a donut, don't eat it.
Yeah.
You know, say, no, thank you. I would like to live longer.
Yeah, no way it's good for you. I want to go back to estrogen again, because I had a few more questions. So how is estrogen working on mitochondria? What's it doing for mitochondria?
Well, everything. So there are receptors for estrogen in mitochondria. Absolutely. And mitochondria are where energy is made. Mm-hmm. So without estrogen, you have problems with creating energy. You also lose mitochondria. They actually die off. And you need the mitogenesis. You need to have new mitochondria. So absolutely, mitochondria are essential. And the other thing that is very important to know about estrogen and its role in mitochondria is that when mitochondria create energy, okay, so you know, you have the oxidative phosphorylation and you go down the electron transport chain, mm-hmm. you make energy. In the process of creating energy, you create some amount of what's called oxidative stress. So you create these like oxidative byproducts. So the biggest oxidative byproduct is called, it's O2, okay? And the two oxygens together are very, 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 very toxic. Mm-hmm. Super oxide is what it's called. Now, it turns out that it's estrogen that controls the enzyme that changes superoxide into hydrogen peroxide. It's called superoxide dismutase.
Mm-hmm. SOD, yeah.
I teach you about ACE. It's an enzyme, right?
Yeah.
So superoxide dismutase is an enzyme, and it converts this toxic, very toxic oxidative byproduct of making energy in the mitochondria. It takes this superoxide through using this enzyme, superoxide dismutase, and converts it into hydrogen peroxide. Now you could say, well, hydrogen peroxide, that's pretty toxic too. And it is. But the difference is that superoxide cannot get out of the cell.
Yeah.
It's lost to the cell. So as you build up superoxide and you can't change it and get rid of it, it will kill the cell. Mm-hmm. You will basically damage and then kill that cell. Hydrogen peroxide, on the other hand, which is also toxic, but it can get out of the cell. And then it can go through a whole another whole degradation product, which turns it into harmless water. Okay? And estrogen controls that process too. And as another note, estrogen controls the production of the master antioxidant detoxifier of the body, which is called glutathione, through glutamate cysteine lipase, and glutathione peroxidase. Mm-hmm. Both of those enzymes, right? They're always enzymes with ACE. They are both controlled by estrogen. Mm-hmm. So without estrogen, you can't properly make the master detoxifier of the body, glutathione. So estrogen sustains the life of mitochondria and maintains mitochondrial health and maintains the antioxidant state of the whole body and helps to convert toxic superoxide into hydrogen peroxide and then hydrogen peroxide into harmless water.
That's awesome. So it's an awesome antioxidant.
Yes, it is. Absolutely. And so, of course, this process is going on everywhere. There's mitochondria everywhere, right? Mm-hmm. And the most mitochondria, of course, are in the brain and also in the heart.
Well, so that makes sense that you have a lot of estrogen in the ovaries because that's where you have the most mitochondria. And so it needs to keep...
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I'm sad to say the lipopolysaccharides that can get out, you know, when you're having a bad gut health.
The endotoxin.
Yeah, the endotoxin, it's actually directly toxic to the ovaries as well. Oh. It actually poisons the ovaries and the eggs, the oocytes. They actually poison our oocytes.
Is that part of what's going on in PCOS?
That is part of what goes on in PCOS. PCOS is a very complicated condition, but almost all women with PCOS have a dysbiotic gut. They have systemic inflammation. They have estrogen receptor dysfunction. Most of them have insulin resistance. 80% are overweight and obese. And because they don't have proper estrogen functioning, their estrogen receptors are not right. They also have a high rate of anxiety and depression, irritable bowel syndrome, arthritis, all the things, a lot of the things that you think about with menopause, they're sort of happening at a young age because of these receptor problems and the gut dysbiosis. So it's a huge problem. It's the most common endocrine disorder of women.
Yeah, that's awful. It's becoming more and more prevalent now.
It is. Some people think up to 25% of women have some degree of PCOS.
Wow, that's unbelievable. So how does...
I'm hoping to have a book out on PCOS in the next 6 months.
Oh, I'm excited to read that. Does it have a name yet?
No, but I'm going to have a whole series on PCOS, a series. But the first one is going to be about nurturing the gut microbiome to help heal PCOS.
That's awesome. That's a good place to start.
That's where I'm starting. You start with the gut, right?
Yeah. So how does estrogen... I want to know how estrogen affects bile and the gallbladder, because you have the four Fs in gallbladder disease, which is fat, fertile, female, and 40. So how is estrogen affecting bile and creating gallstones?
Well, it all comes back to the gut, okay? So there's a lot of communication between all the different organs. A lot of people don't realize that estrogen is actually key to parietal cell function, making stomach acid, and it also triggers the production of digestive enzymes that come out of the pancreas, which is why after menopause, for example, before menopause, women have a much lower incidence of acid reflux GERD than men, but after menopause, it's actually much higher. And then they have a lot of digestive problems. So there's a whole link. Everything communicates with everything. So when you have a situation where you're not producing stomach acid properly, you're not producing digestive enzymes properly, you have a lot of times this is involved with fatty liver. Mm-hmm. So you have a lot of inflammation in the liver. You have all the signaling. You know, there's a hormone like cholecystokinin that's involved in gallbladder function. So the whole system is completely linked to estrogen, and it's all about communicating within this whole network. And so bile is another one of those things that is a multitasker. It's actually, you know, they bile is vile. It's actually toxic waste. But like everything in the body, it's multitasking. So it's a, bile is also a signaling agent. It's also an emulsifier that helps you to digest fats, and it has feedback on the onto the brain. So it's very complex, and the solution is almost never to take out the gallbladder, which is so common, you know. And then when the gallbladder is removed, it's treated like, ah, who needs it? Like, And then you can't, you know, there's the whole point of the gallbladder is to time the release of the cholesterol and the bile to coincide with when you're eating foods that have fat so that you can actually digest. And then they, women can't absorb their fat soluble vitamins even. And then you create massive nutrient deficiencies. Mm-hmm. And without a gallbladder, you often get what they call dumping syndrome, because the whole gut, the whole, remember the enteric nervous system, which I mentioned, is all involved with estrogen. There are receptors on with the myocytes, the muscle cells. There are nerve plexes. There is the enteric glial cells. So there's all these different aspects of the nervous system of the gut, and as well, you know, it the gut makes more melatonin than the brain does, and the melatonin acts as a signaling agent as well. And actually, it's interesting with melatonin, it actually can cause some of the gut microbiota at night when you have the melatonin come out to actually swarm, and it actually creates a signaling kind of a thing with other microbiome, and these actually create other signals to the gallbladder. So it is very complex, but the bottom line is that estrogen in some way, and we're just learning about this, that's why I can't be completely definitive, but it's like still the master controller of all these different aspects of the intestinal tract. And we're just, you know, just getting to the bottom of, I should say, really the top layer of understanding how all of these
the
things.
The tip of the iceberg.
The tip is right. How they communicate with each other to make things work properly. But remember, the gallbladder has its own nervous system, right, that makes it contract. Mm-hmm. And what estrogen is part of the nervous system of every organ in the intestinal tract. And the gallbladder has to contract properly. That's why, like, women have a lot of peristalsis problems, right? They have more constipation, more irritable bowel syndrome. So you can think of the gallbladder as sort of a continuum of poor contractile function.
That makes sense. Yeah. A few more questions. So so you said with lifestyle, you should start off with a vegan diet if you have dysbiosis, and then move into what kind of diet?
A predominantly vegan, but adding in some animal. But you only have to add in about 4 ounces of animal protein a day.
Okay.
So, and then when you cook it, the optimal way to cook animal is low heat in moisture, so you don't create advanced glycation.
So you don't oxidize it, yeah.
Right, oxidize it, create advanced glycation end products, right?
Ages.
So grilling, broiling, roasting are not optimal ways.
Mm-hmm.
Stews, soups, you know, lightly, you know, sauteing in broth, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. What about meal timing? So
meal timing is very important. The optimal, I'm very pro breakfast, but you don't have to eat the second you wake up, but you know, optimally by an hour after you get up is good. It really helps to shut down the cortisol and tells your body everything's good. We have food today. Yeah. So it does help. They've done studies showing that your metabolic system, like you can, if you eat, now very few people are willing to do this, but if you eat 2/3 of your calories for breakfast and 1/3 for lunch and just a few bites for dinner, in 1 month's time, you can have your insulin level. So if people have diabetes,
that's awesome.
You know, they're really metabolically unstable. Just by doing that, you can literally have their, you know, circulating insulin level. And insulin is pro-fat production, pro-fat storage, and it's quite pro-inflammatory when you have too much insulin. Mm-hmm. So want to have, you want to have some insulin, otherwise you're like a type 1 diabetic. You don't want to have no, you don't want too much. It's like too much of a good thing you do not want.
You so, want it when you really need it.
Exactly. When you need it, you want it. Exactly. Yeah. And so meal timing is very important. This whole idea that came out some years ago that you should eat like every 2 hours to maintain your blood sugar is insane. Mm-hmm. Your body is self-regulating. If humans had to evolve to eat every 2 hours, we would probably be extinct long ago. Mm-hmm. Because humans would obviously not find food every 2 hours if they were living in prehistoric times. You know, that just, and how would they get
it? They carry snacks with them all the time.
Eating all the time, right? You'd be so busy eating. I have two different color faces here. Oh, well, this is what you call sun changing. Okay. So, tell me if I need to do anything.
Oh, you're great. Yeah.
Fine. Okay. Yeah. Whatever. So definitely eat breakfast. In an optimal setting, you could really eat just two meals a day. And that's not to reduce intake of nutrients. It's just to sort of coalesce your nutrients into two meals. But if you really can't do that, you get too hungry, then have a third meal, either a light lunch or a light dinner. And try not to eat dinner after 8 o'clock at night, because your pancreas goes to sleep because everything's on a timer, you know, with your circadian rhythm.
The clock genes, yeah.
So you don't want to preferably eat too late, and you don't want a snack. So you want to eat preferably two meals. But if you want to have three meals, make one quite light and mostly with fat, because fat doesn't really increase what we call mTOR, mm-hmm. which causes proliferation. You don't want to constantly be in a state of proliferation. It sounds good.
That way you can stay young forever.
Cancer, you know. You want some growth, but you don't want uncontrolled growth.
Yeah.
It's like you want it when you need it, but not all the time. So you don't want to constantly be eating, because you're going to keep your mTOR upregulated all the time, and you'll be in a constant state of proliferation and not burning. You can't burn and grow at the same time. You know, you're either burning or growing, you know, so you want a balance of the two.
Exactly.
And so if you have to snack, eat something like a few macadamia nuts or some olives. Those are really good snacks if you have to snack. What you don't want to have is a carb or a protein, really. You don't want that as a snack. So best to stay with fats, like some nuts or seeds, things like that. Or if you like coconut oil, you can have a tablespoon of coconut oil, or even some really, really dark chocolate, unsweetened, like 80-something% dark chocolate.
Yeah, it's got a lot of benefits to that.
Tea, hydrate.
With women who are in menopause, what are some good supplements that they could use?
Well, I work with a company called Pure Encapsulations, and I've created.
I love them. Just,
you do like that. I love them too.
They're just what you want. They don't put any other additives and things in it.
Right.
Yeah.
So I have what I devised is called the Pure Woman line. So I actually have a Pure Woman cognitive line for menopausal women to help them with brain health. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to have a new one coming out for cardiovascular. I have one for metabolic, and I have one for polycystic ovary syndrome, but it's called ovarian health. It's not called PCOS. But it's ovarian health. So, you know, some of the things I love that are just sort of mainstays would be things like resveratrol and curcumin for anxiety and for cognitive health. I also like bacopa, rhodiola, and acetylcysteine, which is a precursor of glutathione, but it has other functions directly in its own right. And, of course, omega-3 is, and you definitely, everyone should have some vitamin D. Make sure you have an adequate amount of vitamin D. So those are, and of course, like a high quality multivitamin. I like I always give a probiotic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to
help. Any specific strains?
Well, I like a blend. So if a woman has, for example, a vaginal infection, then I usually give the strains of the lactobacillus. And for general gut health, usually a blend of lactobacillus and bifidobacteria.
Mm-hmm. That's
and
good.
Then, you know, it depends. If someone's been on antibiotics, and I do the sarcomyosis, but, you know, but generally speaking, I use just a simple blend with the lactobacillus and the bifidobacterium. And then I do encourage eating fermented foods, which we didn't really talk about.
That's a whole other discussion.
Right. You get, I love supplements, but I use the word supplement appropriately. It's to supplement everything else that's foundational.
After that lifestyle, then you supplement.
Right. Yeah. Supplementing without a good lifestyle is not going to get you where you want to be.
Yeah.
Right. But when you add in all the good, healthy lifestyle things, then it can take you to that next level of optimal health.
Yeah. That's how I like to think of it. Yeah, I have a lot of supplements on my website, but most of the times I'm just eating healthy and I don't have to take all the supplements that I talk about for optimal health.
I'm just moving this because I'm going to get
for the light.
So much sun. That's better.
A lot better.
I have so many windows here. I know.
Okay. It's nice and bright. It's good for your circadian rhythm.
You're right. Everyone should get some bright light in the middle of the day.
I use an app called DMinder, which you can get for iPhone or Android, that tells you when solar noon is based on your GPS.
Oh, great.
So perfect time to go out in the middle of the day and things like that.
Well, it's great when, I know it's hard when people have careers that don't allow them to run outside, but you got to try to take the initiative, do whatever you can to try to live according to the way we're supposed to live. We're not supposed to be like animals in cages in a zoo, because we've already learned that when you do that to animals, they don't do very well. That's why they created new zoos that allow animals to be in a more natural habitat, because you stick any living creature in the wrong environment, then they're not going to do well. And we've done that to ourselves and our children, which breaks my heart.
So what's the best way to detox from endocrine disruptors and xenohormones, things like that?
Well, I actually have a pure woman detox protocol as well.
Oh, you do?
I do. But basically, so you want to do, if you're dealing with like an estrogen type of detox, which I do quite a bit, or else, but if it's a heavy metals, then I use things like chlorella, that type of thing for a heavy metal detox. But and sort of sulforaphane, you've probably heard of that.
Oh yeah, I love broccoli sprouts.
Yeah. From things like broccoli, and then DIM is what I use a lot of. Mm-hmm. Green tea, of course, and some tyrosine and other amino acids are all very, very helpful.
What is tyrosine doing in the body? I'm curious about that.
It helps with the sulfation pathway for detox.
That
which
makes
is
more
the
sense.
Glutathione, the glutathione pathway.
Okay.
And so that can be quite helpful. And there's like nothing it seems that green tea can do. I don't know what that it's
oh, yeah.
like.
It's got so many benefits to it.
When in doubt, have some tea, right?
Every week there's a new study about its new benefit.
It is pretty amazing. And then I also use extracts related to milk thistle. Which I'm sure you know.
Silmarin, yeah.
Yes, Silmarin, right. So those are some of the mainstays. And of course, in my office, we also do IV. So we can do IV antioxidants, which can also help people a lot.
Like a Myers cocktail of some sort?
Exactly, yeah.
Cool.
That's the thing that can help people.
Yeah, those are awesome. For testing for people in menopause, what should they do?
Well, I love doing a lot of testing because, we're talking about non-invasive testing. Mm-hmm. So I use the Cleveland Heart Lab, and so they have their own proprietary labs like TMAO, myeloproxies, mm-hmm. and they have, I get like F2 isoprostanes, which is a measure of oxidative stress. So I get all their inflammatory markers, and then I get a lipid profile that's more against, looking at particles like APOL, lipoprotein A1 and B, and fractionated HDL, LDL, and so on. Because just getting a standard lipid profile, you might as well flip a coin. Nothing really doesn't tell you a whole lot about your risk. And then, of course, I get hormones. I look at things like pregnenolone, which is an adrenal. It's also a neuroendocrine hormone produced in the brain. And I look at estrogen, testosterone, and so forth, LH and FSH. And then I look at thyroid antibodies. I test just about everyone now who isn't feeling well. They're perfectly healthy, or maybe not, but it seems like nobody's perfectly healthy, at least not that I see. Yeah. But I test for gluten antibodies, and I do a lot of gut tests.
Is that anti-gliadin antibodies?
Yes, and I do advanced gluten particles, and then I use a lot of tests with Genova Laboratories, so I get nutritional profiles, and I can actually get the gut microbiome tested, like you mentioned.
So Genova has some of those, GI effects, comprehensive effects or something?
GI effects, yeah. And NutriEval, so I get those very commonly. So I get a lot of information. Then we also do vascular ultrasounds in my office, so I can get echocardiograms. Echocardiogram is very useful, not just for looking at heart valves, which, of course, in people with high blood pressure, that they'll often have valvular problems, but also you can look at what's called mild diastolic dysfunction, which is actually the first sign that a heart muscle, the myocytes themselves, are energy deficient. So it's the first sign of an energy-deficient heart. So it really is very helpful. And there are estrogen receptors in the heart muscle cells themselves as well. Mm-hmm. So, and we know that there's also an epidemic now of heart failure and atrial fibrillation. And, you know, my goal is being proactive. I don't want people to suffer end-stage diseases when there's very little often that can be done to help at that point, other than giving the pharmaceuticals or procedures and ablations and things like that. So we want to be, in my practice, I am proactive, so people never go down that road. And I also do carotid intima media thickness. So I do the carotid so we can see what the endothelial lining is like. And sometimes I'll get testing of the lower extremities, looking at peripheral artery disease. So I do a lot of testing. None of it is invasive, and all of it is very informative.
That's awesome. Good to hear you have a wide array of tests that you can use.
Yeah.
So what is one way that I'm going to end on this note? What is the best thing a young woman can do to prevent her from disease?
So she needs to recognize, like we talked about, that hormones are what she is, right? Hormones are destiny, and she should embrace her hormones, which means she should embrace her reproductive and beautiful lunar menstrual cycle. She should try very hard to find a contraceptive that isn't an oral contraceptive or another chemical endocrine disruptor like an IUD or an implantable or a shot that has these so-called progestins, which are really endocrine disruptors as well. Yeah. As a side note, I just want to mention that the progestin-embedded IUD, a published study just out of Finland just this past month, very recent, showed that that particular type of IUD, I won't mention the brand, but it has levonorgestrel in it, which is a progestin chemical, made-up name, but it's a chemical endocrine disruptor for progesterone, has a 52% increased risk for developing breast cancer.
Wow.
And they also found a 34% increased risk of developing breast cancer in oral contraceptive users. This is, people are not getting informed consent. So I'm not wanting people to get unwanted pregnancies. And it's not like there's any really wonderful solution. I would like to bring up the conversation so maybe we can find better solutions to preventing unwanted pregnancies. You know, but the solution can't be that we give poison to young women. That's not a good solution. You know, we have to look for other solutions. So I'd rather women use the copper IUD. Not that that's, you know, perfect in any sense, but it's better. You know, we have to pick the best of the what we've got. You know, condoms, old-fashioned diaphragm would be better, you know, than using the chemical things that increase risk of cancers that are very significant. And we don't even know what they do long-term for the immune system. We do know that women on oral contraceptives have significantly higher rates of Crohn's disease and other autoimmune diseases, autoimmune thyroid, and depression. So, I mean, these have a myriad of effects that are just being whitewashed, and we need to bring up the conversation. So a young woman should look at all the available contraceptive options, and try, if possible, not to use the chemical pretend hormone ones. Mm-hmm. Well, she needs to eat real food, you know, follow my Dr. Gersh's law, because many women, when they go to college, you know, they talk about the, you know, the freshman 15, well, I've seen the freshman 40, you know, and where they gain a lot of weight. College seems to be the most unhealthy time in the, you know, 4 years, sometimes longer, and people have terrible habits. They go to sleep at crazy times. They have a lot of stress. They drink a lot of alcohol. They eat toxic, crappy food. So I would say, you know, I want you to have a fun time, but, you know, maintain, you know, your sense of health, you know, and try to hang out.
On top of all the stress from the schoolwork.
Right. You know, surround yourself with other like-minded people. You know, you are you're the company you keep. Mm-hmm. So find like-minded peers, people who care about themselves, like people who go to the school gym and, you know, want to eat healthy foods and you know, send letters to the administration. Where's our vegetables? You know, we don't want to have just iceberg lettuce. That's not an adequate selection for, you know, a salad bar and so forth. So, you know, be an advocate for health, hang out with healthy people. And, you know, I'm not saying you can't go to happy hour at the bar, you know, but try to be reasonable. Nobody is watching what you drink. You don't have to. You could have, you know, a sparkling water with some pineapple juice and a splash of lime. That's what I do all the time. It looks very festive and nobody knows what I'm drinking. And, you know, it's fine. Just have a good time, but try not to sacrifice your health in the process. Try to go to bed at a reasonable time. Try to eat, you know, real food with regular times of eating. Try not to put a lot of poison in your body. If you marijuana now is all over the place, and just recognize that marijuana is one of the most toxic in terms of grown with pesticides, you know. Mm-hmm. So, you know, keeping the whole thing about marijuana, whether it's good, bad, or whatever, as a drug, but, you know, as an herbal type of drug, but most marijuana is just laced with toxic pesticides and herbicides.
Yeah, that's awful. Yeah.
It's, you know, and there is some issues in terms of long-term cognitive effects, because the endocannabinoid system is not a simple system. And by the way, it's also regulated by estrogen. So,
is it really?
Yes.
Yeah. We need to go through that right now.
another time. But yes. Yeah,
so okay.
Drug use and recognize, you know, what's in marijuana. You know, I don't want you to have unwanted pregnancies, but try not to use those chemical toxic stuff. And, you know, just love who you are as a young woman, and, you know, get out, exercise, you know, laugh, be selective, don't get sexually transmitted diseases, you know, be careful, use protection for that. I've seen way too many cases of gonorrhea and chlamydia, you know, so, and HPV, by the way, that's another whole talk. I have great concerns about the HPV vaccine, mm-hmm. but another time. But so basically, you know, it's just do all the right things. These are like the formative years when you grow bone. By the way, women on oral contraceptives never reach their potential peak bone density. That's been shown. So, and you need a healthy, robust musculoskeletal system.
Yeah.
So, get the sun, exercise, go to sleep at the right time, don't eat all the time, and eat only real healthy food. Eat lots and lots of vegetables, and enjoy your life. Laugh and smile a lot.
That's a great answer. Thank you.